First of all, let me take just a few moments to thank all the viewers and the listeners, the hearers, those the considerers. There's not a lot of us here, but I'd rather have a core group of those that keep showing up than a whole bunch of people, you know, listen to something that's not true, that's not real. I try to keep it real here, and it doesn't attract many, but the ones that are viewing keep coming back and keep coming back, so it's consistent. So I'd like to thank all of you very much. This whole thing is actually very, very helpful, and ultimately will be extraordinarily helpful. So you're really participating in something that is really valuable, very, very valuable. And I talk about the tools we need to use, and I needed to use them today, and I had trouble. I had so much success this morning in the most profound meditation of my life that I said, oh my gosh, I sort of freaked out. I said, what am I going to do? This is so valuable. And I started getting real upset with the Holy Spirit and angry because there's no structure. I don't see any structure for me to really present, you know, the value of it to the world at all. There's just no tradition here in the West, or the world is just losing its whole tradition. I don't know. I wouldn't have a clue what to do. It's terrible. So I got very upset. A brutally difficult day, because it's just the contrast between the world and the meditation that I did was just, it's just, you can't even compare the two. This is the price we pay. So for success, it's very difficult price to pay. So the profundity of the meditation and insight and inquiry I did this morning, lying in bed, I woke up about 5 in the morning or earlier than that, and I just said, well, let me just go for it, like I always do. You have to really want, you must abhor, you know, ignorance and suffering and self-delusion. Just find it totally abhorrent. In order to really succeed, you just have to, you cannot find any solace in it whatsoever, really. So you just have to look at yourself within your mind, within your own awareness. You cannot get it just by looking externally at even the pictures of Ramana Maharshi and these nice spiritual sayings and all this stuff. No, that is not going to get the job done at all. Now, a little of that is fine. You know, some external, a lot internal is probably the right formula. You know, it helps to keep your mind on truth if you keep spiritual stuff going in your life constantly. But that cannot be the heart and soul of it at all. What we have to look within. Nobody can go within and tell you what they find there and say, oh, and you say, oh, okay, great, now I know. It doesn't work that way. Really, nothing that's being said in the world is really it at all, actually. Not actually, even though I tried to explain it, it's still not it. It's still not it. You have to see the context. You have to see it. You have to experience it yourself. That's the only way. That's why some of the teachers, I think Buddha said, look, don't take anything that I say as true. Test it out. Find out for yourself. That's maybe the best advice, you know, there is. Don't take anything as true that anyone says. I don't care who it is. Test it out, look within, see what you see, see what you can see, see what insight you can get. So this morning I got insight that, you know, I said, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? You know, what am I going to do? This is so valuable. It's so valuable what I saw this morning. You just cannot put it. I would not trade all the riches of the universe for what I saw this morning. Not even remotely would I change it, trade it. So this puts you, you know, it puts one in this position like, oh, what do I do? What do I do with this value? I'm, you know, I've experienced value. You know, I'm experiencing value. This is valuable. And yet the day goes on like as if oblivious to it, totally oblivious. I keep looking for signs of the Holy Spirit saying, yeah, yeah, yeah. But my experiencing externally is just total oblivion to this. Like the world is completely oblivious. Nothing happened today, really. Well, I did come across Ramana Maharshi's Facebook page. Yeah, there's a Facebook page, facebook.com, Ramana Maharshi. And it's got all this really, I mean, it's probably the best eye candy I've ever seen, really. If you go through all the posted pictures, you know, just there's so much exquisite eye candy and many pictures of Ramana I've never seen. But it really didn't do anything for me. Compared to the insight I had this morning, it was like nothing. But still, it was interesting just to see, you know, all this artistic stuff that's, you know, very, I don't know if that's anything or not. It's always nice to see Ramana Maharshi. But again, looking within is better. Looking within is better. It's better. What you find in there is just so wowish. You just cannot compare anything external to it. There are no eyes. This is what I took practice that I took out of all that. There are no eyes. It's not a question of I. It's eyes. Are there any eyes at all? I don't mean physical eyes. I mean I, like I am this or I am that, or the I, the personality. Are there any centers, like the eye of a hurricane? Take a look at that. Are there any centers, eye of a hurricane, at all? And I saw there's not. There is not. Because there's nothing to be liberated from. There's no bondage to get unstuck from. The eye is really this focus, this attempt to get unstuck. But there's no stuckness. There isn't any stuckness at all. So I was seeing this and seeing how we keep trying to start out very subtly, say, well, I have subtle stuckness. How can we have subtle stuckness when there isn't any stuckness at all? How can we be liberated when there's nothing bound at all? There's nothing bound at all. There's no bondage at all. So how can there be an I that frees up itself from bondage? The bondage doesn't exist. So there is no path. There is no center. There is no effort. And in the meditation, I kept wandering off the reservation, and I said, "Bring it back! Bring it back! Bring it back!" You'll notice this, that your thoughts will start to wander off, and you have to bring it back. So, super successful meditation, you would have to say. And again, there's no way to convey it. So you can say, oh, okay, I get it. You have to do it for yourself. You have to keep trying. This is the, you know, best advice. Just, you have to keep trying, like somebody who's dying of thirst. And you know that there's a glass of water inside. You just have to find it. So it's really that intense. You know, I've got to find, you know, what is going on. So What we do is we think there's something subtle, we define it as subtle, and then contrast, and have a path so we can contrast it. We make a path of contrast, and then we contrast the less subtle with the subtle, what we define as subtle, and then claim that the less subtle is therefore bound, you see. Stuck. But what I saw is there's no such thing as the subtle. There's no subtle stuckness at all. So there's no position we can take to start out on any path of contrast and say, well, this is a starting point, a starting point. There isn't any starting point. There is no stuckness. There's no such thing. If there's no stuckness, there can't be subtle stuckness. Oh, I'm just subtly stuck, very subtly stuck. No, it doesn't exist. As soon as we think that there's something subtle in terms of stuckness, then we're lost in the ego, lost in delusion. And there was a lot more to it, but I'm trying to, give at least some flavor to it. Very cold here now. The California weather's turned cold, and jet stream is dipping way south. Really different than we're used to the last 4 years. Nothing like this. But we'll take it. We'll take it. Snow in the Sierras. Hey, great. Fabulous. Early snow in the Sierras. Wow. See, in California, the drought is a big deal because it's our civilization will collapse here if we don't get water this winter. Drove through a very wealthy area today, and some of the houses had completely let their lawns die, and others had their lawns sparkling like emerald jewels. I mean, like they had just been fertilizing and watering and just, lush. It's incredible. It just shows you. The difference in people. Some people get it and some people don't. Same thing with the truth is some want to get it and some don't care and just are oblivious to it. So you have to be someone who really wants it, like someone who's just parched with thirst and just this and hunger, just famished, absolutely famished. And we should be famished because there's nothing to feed on in this world at all. So it's important then when you have these great insights to when you do your meditation, you're looking within your concentration, you're looking to see your mind and following, trying to clarify. It's important that you manage your success of that and claim, insist that this is the new norm for you now. This is the new norm. So it's not a big deal because this is now normal for me to see this clearly. This is just a new norm. You see, as long as we keep searching for enlightenment, we keep trying to contrast. And it's contrast that is deluding us, actually. It's the whole idea of this false self is based on the idea of contrast having meaning. But when we flatten it all out and see there isn't any stuckness at all, so how can there be contrast in stuckness? There can't be. Then the you would say the ego would disappear, would disappear. And then we would be like Ramana Maharshi, we'd be like that. I mean, that's how we're going to be. It's a good example. No contrast. Flatten it all out. Totally flatten it out. No contrast. No contrast, no ego. And the ego will say, well, yeah, but there's no liberation. Right, there we don't need liberation. From what? From contrast, I guess you could say. We need liberation from the ego, but that's the only liberation we need. And there is no ego. I mean, there isn't any I, there isn't any beginning to a path of contrast, actually, because there's no stuckness. There's nothing to be liberated from. We're free already. So the tools of the path are the most important issue by far, by far. If you don't have the tools, you'll just get still, you'll just be superficial. If we have the tools, then we can begin managing our success. When we start looking within, we have to start having success, and we have to manage that success. It's not easy. I had a brutally difficult time today. It was quite agonizing because I said, "Wow, I don't know. I don't have any mentors, in the world. I have no idea what to do." I mean, maybe Eckhart Tolle, sat on a park bench, for a couple of years. That's what he did. Well, it worked for him, at least apparently. So what do you do when it's all flattened out and there's no more contrast, therefore no ego. no contrast thoughts arising at all. I don't know. Do we have a, you know, all these role models within? Have I been mentored? No, I've not by anyone here in the world. So I don't know. I don't know. I wouldn't have a clue what to do. And I in my mind, I don't see anything, you know, any pathway opening up to, you know, this is what you'll be doing. Nothing at all. So I just said, wow, you know, this, I don't know. I guess I just have to find out and just keep, you know, keep my nose to the grindstone. And but I said, you know, it's I'm so close. I kind of figure like I'll have at least I'll get some idea, you know. I mean, but no. So I do feel extremely close to, you know, liberation from the idea of liberation, from the falsity of there's something to be liberated from. That's liberation. Liberation is being liberated from the false idea that there's something we need to be liberated from. That's it. So I'm very close to that. Knocking on the door, you know, I mean, it just did. And yet, I'm still, it's complete. Not a clue as far as how would I function, what would I do. It is, whatever I think of it, it just falls apart. No, I mean, and is there anybody out in the world really interested? Maybe not. Maybe a few. You know, are there a few that are actually looking within and managing their success and walking together in the wow and you know, glimpsing, you know, the fact that, hey, you know, maybe I can be liberated because I am starting to see there's nothing to be liberated from. Wow. Wow. You know, maybe few and far between, you know, really. I mean, most people are so superficial. Most of us are so superficial. They're not interested in, they're just trying to find some better contrast, really. Now, positive use of eye candy is to recognize that eye candy isn't it. And there is something to be said for that. A lot of the videos I've done are for that purpose. I try to do some, you know, really extraordinary presentation of graphics and all this stuff. So, and you know, you watch it and you think, oh, this is great. And at the end, you kind of say, huh, you know, that really didn't go that deep. It was kind of superficial. That's the whole point of it, you know. It's purposeful. I know it's superficial. But recognizing that it's superficial is a big step. You're saying, wow, that's not going to get the job done. The pictures, you know, all the graphics and sayings and everything, that's not it. But having it condensed and, you know, just powerfully realize, oh, you know, this isn't it. That's helpful. It's helpful. But the path is ridiculously difficult, is the problem. It's just, I can't even explain it, really. It's doable, but most don't do it. And so they go to someone and say, oh, you do it for me. You know, I can't do that. That doesn't work. Nobody can do it for someone else. It's not possible. So it's kind of bittersweet. I'm feeling this sort of bittersweet feeling like, okay, well, maybe I can do it. But what good is that really? You know, is that really, does that mean like all millions are going to be able to? No, it might not mean anything, you know, really. The stick-to-itiveness is just off the charts. Yeah, you have to be driven, and you know it comes from within. Nobody can drive you externally the way you need to be driven. It comes from within. You just have to be suffering so bad. You're just driven, like you're on fire. You know, it's like someone on fire running towards a lake. This is pretty much what it's like. This is like my life, I like burning up with suffering, and I've got to get to that water and jump in. And the pain is just horrible, so it's like that, really. So the ones who watch these videos tend to be ones that are suffering a lot. You know, just go, oh, I just can't take this, you know, world anymore. It's just horrible. Well, that's good. That's a very good step. You know, but then we have to actually have the discipline and determination and the tools, you know, to sit still, be quiet, sit still. Often the best is when I wake up early in the morning, just lie in bed. Don't move, just lie in bed, and then just start watching my mind and saying, okay, you know, and it takes a while to get into it. Don't give up, don't give up. Just keep trying and 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 trying. Just don't give up. And gradually, you know, you'll start to pick up on some clarity and insight. It's insight meditation, clarity meditation, seeing, awareness, looking, and you begin to go get into it and recognize, like, wow, I'm starting to see the landscape, you know, the inner landscape of the mind, how it works, and how we've been, you know, tricking ourselves. Begin to see that inner landscape of purpose and intention. And tricks, mental tricks. This is the landscape. You see this inner landscape. It's not like the world with, you know, dirt and trees and everything like that. It's the intention and defenses and clever little mental tricks and hopes and desires and fears and, you know, and look at the structure of the psyche and the, what's going on there. You know, look, this is called looking within the mind, what the way the mind is working. And this looking, you know, it goes on and on and on and on and on and on and on. It's not easy. But this is what gets the job done. Looking at a picture of a beautiful flower is not going to get the job done with a heart on it, you know. That's nice, but it's not going to get the job done. It's window dressing. Maybe it gets you in the store, you know, possible. But it's just window dressing. So if we just spend all the time browsing, you know, window, looking at the window dressing, we're never going to go into the store. We've got to go into the store. Start looking at the store. What's in here? Wow. Look at this place. It can be pretty intimidating looking at the mind and recognizing all this, what's going on, and you look at just, wow. But we have the right. It's our own mind we're looking at. We're the ones who are guiding it, directing it. Really. So, and progress happens. I mean, this insight was the deepest I've ever gone, the clearest I've ever gone. Better than the one before, which was at that time the best I've ever done. So I have made a lot of progress since I really went very, very deep and clear about what's going on, took a real deep look. And so, matter of a couple of days, you know, a lot of the new norm sets in, and then we're able to go even further. Sometimes it sets in quicker, sometimes it takes a little while. And it's frustrating. You think, oh, I should be able to get it now. But it takes, you have to let it feel like this is normal to me. This is normal. And then you're able to go further and take an even clearer look at it. Now, is it the same as, you know, these teachers say? Or, well, you know, it both is and it isn't. It seems unique to us, the way we're looking at it. I wouldn't describe the same way as others have described it necessarily. I'm talking about, you know, the contrast in the I, what we think is an effort to get unstuck. We think the I is going to get us unstuck, but to start out with the I, there has to start out to be some stuckness. So it can then use contrast to to claim, well, this is what I'm working on. This is worse stuckness, you know, ultimately, you know, but it says, well, it's so much worse that then we, you know, we don't even think that the subtle stuckness is has nothing, you know, it's just, it's not a big deal. Don't need to focus on that. And that distracts us from the truth, because the truth is that there isn't any stuckness at all. We're not stuck. What can be stuck? We're free. So the ego, the path of the ego is this path of seeming to liberate us from, you know, being not free. And it, again, it works through contrast, and it, so this, it starts out very subtle and gross, and finally we end up here in this world, you know, this world's very, very gross. And the ego says, well, this is where you need to get liberated from this world because it's so gross. And I say, wait a minute. You know, let's look at the, what about the, let's go trace it back, you know. And but the ego says, well, you know, yeah, I mean, why even bother, you know? Obviously, you got to get liberated from this world. It's so gross, so grossly stuck, you know, and then worry about the other stuckness later. I say, whoa. First, let's talk about how, what do you mean stuck? How is it that there's stuckness happen? How did that happen? Yeah, and then that, you know, this is inquiry. How did that happen, that we're stuck? What's stuck? What do you mean stuck? Are we really stuck or just pretending to be stuck? Start asking questions of the ego. Look at the position. See the position you're taking mentally, and then start asking questions. Start inquiring into it. Flip it. Flip the script this way. Flip it this way. Flip it that way. And say, well, before, you know, what if there is no stuckness? You know, what if? What if there isn't any stuckness at all? Then, you know, why should we be just focusing on this gross, what you call grossness? Why not just see that all is free and there are no levels of stuckness at all? So challenge what you see mentally. Challenge it and say, let me look at this. Let me look at it this way. Let me look at it that way. Turn it around in all different directions and look at it and ask questions and say, well, and loosen it up. Say, wait a minute, maybe, you know, maybe we can look closer at this. Let's look a little closer. Look a little closer at this. This is it. This is the path. You look a little closer at it. Ask questions. Real questions in terms of, you know, deep questions of your own, what you're seeing. Asking questions of some teacher is not really where it's at all. You have to ask questions of yourself, of what you're seeing, and say, is this, you know, is this true? Or is there another way of looking at this? And persist until you are able to at least get some different ways of looking at it. And say, you know, that takes patience. Sometimes we're resistant to that. Sometimes you just have to wait and keep being insistent. Don't take, you know, no for an answer in terms of, I want to look at this more closely. And don't stop until you're satisfied, that you feel you've really made some headway. So these are the tools. That's what's important. Is you got to be, you know, build your own house, be your own carpenter. You have to have the tools. Don't just say, I want, you know, here's some money, build the house for me. You have to build your own house. So the tools are all important. That's what we emphasize here. We all, you know, this is the main point of emphasis, is not the truth, it's the tools. Because you'll never get to the truth without the tools. So it doesn't matter listening to Rama Maharshi saying that, you know, the self is this and this and that. If you don't have the tools, it does not going to do you any good. And what I find lacking in everyone is they don't have the tools. They're like consumers. They think they go out and buy it. Is the truth is not a something that you go out and buy. It's not a consumer issue at all. And this is why I abhor the society and artificial intelligence, which is catering to our every whim. It's a way of catering to a lot of levels of what we call subtlety and less subtlety and grossness, to be engrossed in catering to the flesh, to the idea of the body in this world. It's terrible distraction, because it turns us all into these sophisticated consumers, and truth is not a consumer issue at all. You can never buy it. So you have to make it, as it were, yourself. And you need the tools for that. And we're a world right now where nobody knows about the tools at all anymore. I don't hear it anywhere. I hear a lot of people blah blah blah, you know, about the truth, you know, now and you know this, but they never rarely talk about the tools. It's all about the tools. Without those, there's not going to be any realization. And you'll just hope that maybe I can get lucky and win it in the lottery or something. No, this is not possible for anyone. It's all about the tools. And then you can have some shop talk about what can be seen, you know, but it's always loops back to the tools. People keep on saying, what is it like? You know, the DJ said, well, it's like this beautiful flower. It's like a sunset. You know, I'm in the now. You know, I'm seeing, it's all one. It's oh, yeah, okay. What is that? That's actually extremely superficial. Very consumeristic. We live in this extraordinarily dark time of consumeristic mentality. And everybody just thinks that it's all about buying it. You know, if I just get enough money, I can get the car I want. And so they don't pay any attention to the tools that they need and actually using them. Being spiritually self-reliant, you know, gaining the tools. It used to be that that's what was really taught. That's what's important. You got to learn the tools. The wow, you know, flipping the script. Making assertions, full stop in the wow, managing our success, neither nor practice to help stabilize, setting this as the new norm. I can, I will, I've already done it, practice. These are the tools that we have. So we're all about the tools here. All about the practicing, all about the tools. Do that and you will succeed. Don't do it and you'll remain superficial. You might be a real nicely trained African gray parrot who can parrot all this stuff. I mean, there's people parroting Ramana Maharshi, you know, they're really good at it. Yeah, they're really well-trained parrots. So what? They're so burning in agony from this horrible pretense and continuity fear. Continuity fear is roasting them, maybe slowly at first, like a frog in a pot, you know, slowly. But then suddenly the frog says, oh my gosh, I gotta get out of this pot. It's too hot. It's getting hotter. So existence is like that. We're in a pot of water, a frog in a pot of water, and it starts out slow fire, then gradually it heats up more and more and more until, you know, we can't take it anymore. So being a trained parrot is, you know, leave that as for the birds. Let them do that. If someone asks me, well, of course in miracles, what does it say? I don't know. I don't know. But I do know the tools that I use to, you know, inquire within. I can paraphrase, you know, I can just sort of get the gist of it, paraphrase, but I haven't learned, you know, the phrases and stuff like that. I never spent time trying to parrot it and memorize it or anything like that. I can't, you know, quote scripture very well at all. It's not important. What's important is, do we have the tools and are we using them? That's it. it in a nutshell. Do we have the tools, and are we using them? Now, some people are tool freaks, you know, where they say, well, yeah, but I have the tool, but there's a better one. You know, they spend their whole lives trying to find better tools. They never use the ones they have. I mean, they run into these people, really, in life that way. Says, well, yeah, I got this perfectly good, you know, tool, like a, you know, table saw, whatever. You know, got this really great tool. It's fine. It's industry standard. It cuts great. There's no problem at all. There's this other brand, you know, costs like 3 times as much. It's way better, you know. I'm saving my money up for that. So I'm not going to cut anything on this thing. You know, it's junk. Well, they never end up cutting anything, actually, because they never get those expensive tools. And so there are those like this. Oh, I'm so sophisticated, you know. I need a more sophisticated practice, you know. They spend their whole lives looking for a more sophisticated practice instead of using what is profound. So I'm saying here, these practices are absolutely profound. Top of the top or most. It's ridiculous to say, well, I need to find better practices. Yes, but parroting scripture, you better practice it. This is just avoidance. It's just avoidance is all it is. Because what's the main, only problem we have? The only problem there is, well, the continuity fear is the problem we have. And you could say that an ancillary problem is that it causes us to not even try. And so what is the problem? We're not trying. What is that laziness? All right. The really only admonishment there is to people is that we're lazy. That's it. It's just we've got a world full of very lazy minds, very lazy spirits. You know, shiftless, lazy. Don't want to work at it. You know, we're all on spiritual welfare here. It's a fact. Bunch of aimless, shiftless, spiritual welfare applicant, you know, recipients is, no, I can't do it, you know, I just put my time in here and maybe I'll get lucky, you know, somehow get lucky somewhere down the line. This is what the world's like, and it's so difficult to get it done here. You know, it's an abomination, this place. The attitudes of people here, the world, absolute abomination, all shiftless, lazy, spiritual welfare recipients. With some shining exceptions here and there, right? And, you know, we know if we're getting it done. We know if we're working hard. And the others just think, oh, well, you know, I'll just, you know, get money, get it from them, that kind of thing. It's like 1% are working at it, and the rest just think, well, yeah, we'll just be super lazy, and we'll somehow manage to buy it off of them or steal it or something. And this is how lazy people think, don't they? Think criminally, don't they? Absolutely, they do. Maybe I'll just steal it from a bank or something. That's what they think. They sit around thinking, how can I get it? How can I get it? How can I get it? But I know this is how it is. I know it for a fact. Because you might say that I'm lazy in terms of earning money, because I put so much effort into the spiritual path. And then if I sit around thinking, how am I going to get money? I don't know. And you start thinking schemes like, well, I can win it this way or win it that way. And this is what happens when you're not willing to work at something, you come up with these schemes. So I know this is true. Same thing with the spiritual path. I don't need to come up with schemes because I work at it. So for me, it's just, this is my profession, this is my business, this is my career, this is my work. I don't think of schemes, really. I'm not scheming. I just say, let's get to work. That's all. It's going to work. It's going to, I'm going to be successful. I know for a fact I will, because I'm just working at it. What, you know, that's all it takes. So no scheming. Whereas I can see others are just doing all this dreaming and scheming of how can I get lucky, you know, how can I fall into the romance of success, you know, spiritual success, like some sort of romance, like some sort of special relationship, you know, instead of just blue collar, you know, get your lunch pail and go to work every day. That's what it really is. That's what it really is. I mean, there's no way to gloss it over. And those who are glossing it over, you shouldn't be doing that. come to see Daddy Guru or Mama Guru, and it'll be all be good. It's all good. It's all be good. No, it's about getting up in the morning and being determined to establish a new norm. I mean, look at these skyscrapers. They don't build themselves. I mean, you got blue collar workers going to work every day saying, hey, I got to build some more stories today. You know, I got to add on to this building. I got to keep working at it until it's finished. That's the attitude you have to have. It's very much a blue collar attitude. Don't hate the rich people and the sophisticated. Have pity on them, you know, because they think they can buy it. They think, I don't have to do that. You know, I'm above that. Yeah, it's the blue collar attitude that wins, absolutely. And you know, it's tough. I mean, my life's been very helpful because I just have not had. I've had such trouble in terms of whatever you have to work at it so difficult. I just don't have it really handed to me on a platter, you know, very much at all. And you get up in the morning and say, you know, good Lord, I'm in big trouble. And hope that something happens. Nothing happens. It's just, wow, I better get after this, you know, and just, so you just feel like driven to work, gotta work at it, gotta work at it, gotta work at it. This is a blessing. This is a big blessing. So where do the ones who succeed come from? They come from, you know, these super billionaire families? No, it doesn't. Usually, you know, it comes from blue collar mentality, actually. Does it come from privileged people? No, not really. Usually not. I get up every day, I feel destitute and extremely worried. And so, you know, I say today, I have to get it. I have to succeed. I work at it, you know, with utmost effort. And if I don't succeed, bitterly disappointed. It's a catastrophe if I don't succeed. So, you know, I guess the Holy Spirit puts us in these situations, you know, that really pressure us, and it pressure's a good thing in terms of motivation. And I think, oh God, can I just take a vacation from this? And you know, it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. I say, wow, this is brutal. Yeah. Well, I better finish then. Better get it, you know, better. Doesn't seem anything's going to take away the suffering except for ultimate success. So, you know, if you are that, you know, sufferer and a blue-collar worker, and you're not afraid of hard work and putting the work in, then you're the one who's going to succeed. So don't feel envious of these others in the world. I don't really pay much attention to them at this time. You know, it's just like, wow, I mean, you know, you got a big, nice house. You got a nice driveway with all these, stones, beautiful stones, driveway, I don't even just. So what? I mean, what does that mean? Nothing. Drive a real expensive, nice car. So what? It's just meaningless. I feel like if I don't get it tonight, my life is likely to be over. I can't take anymore. That's how bad it is. So, yeah, this sharpens your efforts. So, again, if you're a sufferer, turn it into positive. Make lemonade out of it. Use it to motivate your efforts. Use the tools. The tools are where it's at. Not the flowery sayings, not the beautiful pictures of this world, Photoshop with this, the light and all that stuff, making it look like, oh, it's so wonderful. Yeah, a little bit of eye candy. Okay, so what? But that is not where it's at. That's not it. Same with music. Sometimes I listen a little bit of this, a little bit of that. I get, kind of give myself a real rest or something, or watch a little bit of sports or something. But then it's back to the effort. Just sit here, sitting here, just sitting, grinding it out, the difficulty. I'm not gonna make this a long one because it's so cold out here. Losing all my heat through my head, I'm sure. A lot of breath is just vaporizing severely, like we're in the Sierras. This is really quite something. I don't like it. I had a horrible day today. It was a hideous day. The angle of the sun, all these clouds, glary, very cold, raw. I just can't think or function under those conditions. I love heat. I love the sun to be directly overhead, 100, 103 degrees. That's when my mind tends to get very, very clear and focused. But when it's cold and glary and this sun's low, wintry stuff, I can't seem to concentrate. It's terrible. Hate the wintertime. It's funny, I talk to some certain people today. They talk about the snow up in the Sierras. They have a place up there, and they said, "Hot snow." They say, "I hate the snow. Hate it. Just hate the snow." And I said, "That's funny, I do too." Most people think, "Oh, it snowed, it's so wonderful, the snow, isn't it great?" No, it's not great if you're out working in it. Everybody's trying to clear, do all this work, up in the mountains, and it's terrible when there's snow up there. So, and the cold is, it makes you feel like, I need to do something, I need to do something, because if I don't, I'm gonna freeze. Whereas if the heat, the best thing to do is don't do anything. Say, well, I better not do anything because I do. I'm gonna overheat. So it's easy to sit still and quiet when it's hot. But when it's cold, you want to be active. That's the problem. We need to relax our commitment to activity, to disengage from the personality. This is what's all important. So it's tough for cold weather people to get with it, really, who are, they're so industrious, right? Because they say, well, we're not industrious, we're gonna freeze. But the warm climates, they just say, "Oh, let me just sit real quietly in the shade here and not move." And then that helps you automatically start to say, "Well, what do I do then? Well, let me look at the inner landscape then. That's let me let that be my activity, is looking within." Lot of saints and sages have come from warm areas. Not so many from the cold areas. Not so many, but you can see the exceptions to bed. But the thing is, there it's so cold that you get in a cave by a fire and don't move either. So, that also can work. Take refuge in this cave where it's insulated. Get a fire and block up the entrance, and just let the smoke out, and sit back in the cave, the dark cave, and just don't move, and wrap yourself in some warm, and just sit there quietly. That can work too. But it's the obsession with activity, contrasting, working on this path, liberation. Again, there's nothing to be liberated from. That's all that Ramana Maharshi knew. He knew there's nothing to be liberated from. Okay? When we realize this, we'll have the same basic realization. There's nothing to be liberated from. See it. You actually see it, and then you see it as all flat, and you abide in that recognition. Instead of saying, okay, now, whoa, that's very subtle now. And then instead of using it as some point of subtlety to begin another path, you just say, no, it's there's nothing subtle about it at all. It's all completely obvious. There's nothing subtle about realizing there's nothing, that nothing stuck at all. Stuckness is impossible. That's completely blatantly obvious. So there's no reason to start the whole notion of subtlety, of trying to claim that there's something to be liberated from, and there's no point even starting that egoic path at all. And so you just abide in this obviousness. That's all Ramana Maharshi is doing, is abiding in the obviousness of it. Completely obvious, just abiding in that. No subtlety at all to it. To that. You know, there's no reason to say anything is really subtle, actually. Everything is completely present, obviously present. That doesn't mean there isn't beauty, you know. No. The ego has this notion, you know, of subtlety and contrast, that this is what it believes reality is all about, and it's not. So can we be like Ramana Maharshi? Absolutely, of course. Of course we can. The peace, he said, Ramana said, the peace is higher than the bliss. Absolutely it is. I seem to be attracted more to that than the other styles. For instance, the Bengali styles, more sort of towards the bhavas and the bliss. Chaitanya, Ramakrishna, Ananda Maima in the early days, because she was just acting out what Bengali people expected, which all these bhavas are, these spiritual moods. So the Bengali area tends to be more into the bliss and the bhavas and stuff. And Ananda Maima moved out of there and went to northern India, and she became much more, acted in the way of much more the bliss. I mean, sorry, the stillness, the quietness. Big change, because that's what the people there expected. You know, it was all the same to her, But the Ramana said the great stillness, the great bliss, the great calm, the great peace, that is, you know, the higher than the bliss, actually. The Bengalis called her Ananda Maima, overflowing bliss, because that's what that was their spiritual tradition. That's what they, you know, were focusing on. They were looking for that. And that's why Ramakrishna was the way he was, you know, Bengali, intoxicated, God-intoxicated saints and stuff. I'm not really into that. Now, the bliss can be there as an equality of, you know, quality, you would say, but... I think that there's, it's more compelling, the great stillness, it would be more compelling, and it's hard to explain, the great inclusiveness. So don't worry about the bliss, don't aim for the bliss. I used to be, you know, into that, and you know, it didn't work out well, so... I said, you know, nah, that let's go deeper than that. See, you don't give up. When you're doing inquiry, you don't give up. You don't put a time limit on it, really. Although I said I'm not going to do this for a long time, it get too cold. But, you know, just say, I'm just going to keep working this as long as I can. Like when I wake up in the morning early, I say, I just keep working this till the alarm clock sounds. You know, that's it. And even when the alarm clock sounds, I still try to keep going longer. So, Don't worry about time, keeping track of time. Just keep working at it. Don't give up. Go vertical. There's another practice. Go vertical. You say, let me see this as vertical. Let me see everything as vertical. Just insist. I insist on perceiving this as vertical. Meaning, there's no contrast required. It shifts directly. It's a direct shift instead of working through some sort of contrast to be liberated through contrast or some sort of process. No process. Immediate liberation into the vertical of realizing. And doing so, you realize it was never bound at all by any sort of horizontal contrast between the subtle and the gross, between the light and the dark. You know, really, if you look, let's flip the script here. I mean, darkness from the standpoint of this dream could be said to be the ultimate and subtle light. And the light, electromagnetic light that we're seeing, the light, could be termed as extremely gross. Extremely gross. You know, gross manifestation of light, where it's really subtle. It seems like darkness. It's so subtle. The light's so subtle. and then we get that completely backwards and think that the light's trying to liberate itself from the darkness. And, you know, it gets confusing. But that's a nice way to look at it, flipping the script, isn't it? Maybe this so-called darkness is just this game of that's how we're starting out with, you know, this notion of the ego liberation is saying, well, I'm going to make this gross, very gross light. That's just blatantly blaring light, you know. There's no subtlety to it. And then get liberated from that somehow. But no, just liberate everything vertically. Which means it wasn't stuck, actually, was it? It was only a pretense. There doesn't need to be any horizontal path, you know, from the gross back to the subtle to be liberated from the idea of liberation. The vertical is liberating from the idea of liberation. From this notion that there's this path of liberation, a process, time involved, distance, time, form, all this stuff, you have to, you know, no, liberate it vertically. Right now. All aspects, the dark liberated vertically, the light, the subtle light liberated vertically, the gross light liberated vertically, the medium subtle light liberated vertically, all at the same time. We're not trying to bring anything to anything, like, oh, we bring the gross to the subtle, you know, and transform it and do this. No, everything liberated vertically in the now, right now. And so, of course, sophisticates will always look at the blue-collar work and say, well, yeah, you know, congratulations, you're making some progress. That's nice to see, you know, up in their ivory tower, you know. Don't let that bother you. Just learning like water off a duck's back. What else are they going to say? You know, they say, well, that's the rabbit. I don't need to work at it every day. You know, it's pretty easy for me. Yeah, poor little blue-collar worker's got to go to work every day. You know, struggling. I don't know. We're getting some pretty great insights, aren't we, here? I mean, right? It's not exactly just chopped liver here. We're getting some pretty good stuff, and they'll say, "Oh yeah, that's pretty good." But you know, there's a lot of stuff beyond that, and it's always this sort of paternalistic attitude, you know, from the white collar spiritual worker, the lazy, shiftless spiritual welfare recipients, you know, this condescending sort of paternalistic, maternalistic, avuncular, condescending. I can see that you're kind of scratching around there, a little bit of progress there, and you got potential, we're not worried about that. We're on fire. We got to get and jump in the lake. So progress, I'm not judging progress. I'm working. I can notice it, but it's right back to work here. And then they'll say, well, yeah, you reached a certain level of realization, but it's not really the true realization. It still has quite a ways to go. You're just not kind of stuck there, stuck. There's no stuckness, that sort of attitude sort of fails, and you realize there is no stuckness. What do you mean, stuck somewhere? We can't be stuck anywhere. The idea of a self is some sort of stuckness, there is no such self. Like I said, the self is no self, or no self is the self. I mean, no stuckness is the self. We're not stuck anywhere. So when we start wandering off the reservation, liberation, vertical, go vertical with that. Go vertical, vertical liberation, which is, liberation into no liberation. Never we're stuck in this horizontal stuckness, this contrast. Now everything is inherently liberated in itself. There's no such thing as needing contrast for it to be what it is. Yin yang is the contrast, the duality, the contrast, subtle and the gross. Two selves, the subtle self, the gross self, and I'm the subtle self is coming to liberate the gross self from its terrible grossness. This is the lie. This is the deceit. All of it, liberated in the now, liberated right now, liberated in the now. Go vertical with it, go vertical. Go vertical with the sunlight, go vertical with the dirt, go vertical with the backdrop, go vertical with the concrete. Concrete, go vertical. Concrete, go vertical. You don't have to wait on anything. Going vertical means you're not waiting in on anything, right? Just poof, goes vertical. Immediately. The concrete doesn't have to say, well, I gotta weigh, I'm too heavy, I gotta have someone bust me up first and cart me away. No, you're liberated in the now, you're liberated in the vertical right now. A leaf, go vertical, leaf, Don't have to wait for the wind to blow you around. So this going vertical is the only dynamic there is in the world. Look at it that way. These other dynamics are just gimmicks. Contrast gimmicks, actually. The whole world's a gimmick. So, the only dynamic is us, our authority to say, go vertical to this. Whatever I want, go vertical. Everything, go vertical. Right now. Right now. Vertical right now. Whole ocean, whole entire ocean, go vertical right now. The whole ocean just went vertical. Not waiting on anything. So going vertical means not waiting on anything. Not waiting on any gimmick. Okay, any contrast. Not waiting on anything. As it means go vertical. It'll say, well, at first I got no. Go vertical right now. I'm the only authority there is. Say, or our perceptions, I'm the only authority there is. These gimmicks are not authorities. I am the authority. This is the only dynamic there is, going vertical. Go vertical right now. We tell this to ourselves, to our perception. Because, of course, everything we're perceiving is just a perception, right? So we're the ones in control of our perception. We can change our perception from the horizontal to the vertical. I don't know, this is so much better than the eye candy. It's hard to get motivated to do any of that stuff, really, the eye candy stuff. It's just tough. I could do it, but I keep saying no. too much work, and what do you get out of it? Nothing. I used to think it was cool. I used to collect baseball cards, you know. It's like, oh, look at the picture, it's so cool, it's cool. I used to love graphics and pictures and all this stuff. And a lot of it, of course, we do. But gradually we realize that this is way more interesting than the graphics and the pictures, what we're doing here. Way more interesting. But yeah, I've done a ton of work on graphics. I used to have all these programs. Even in the early days of computer, there's some really cool programs that came out, software, of making all these cool fonts and everything. Just, wow. I've used thousands and thousands of fonts, really. So many. I used so many fonts. And they'd make these beautiful banners and graphics with these fonts. And it just, I was a poster maker, a banner maker, all sorts of stuff. So many. I've made just, you know, so many thousands and thousands and thousands of really cool graphics. You know, it's eye candy. But now I look at it, and it's just flat. You know, it's flat. It's flat. There's nothing wrong with it being flat. It's still attractive. It's nice, but it's just flat. Just go vertical, poster. Just go vertical. It's really all this stuff is saying, hey, don't ask me to go vertical, you know. Leave me alone. Now we say, no, hey, you know, hey, beautiful poster, go vertical. Yeah, I just made some really cool stuff, but now I can see, hey, just go vertical. It's all about every single thing you see. It doesn't have to wait on anything else to go vertical, to realize it's not never been stuck. There's no stuckness to it. So whatever you see, you want it to go vertical, just say, hey, this is what I really want. I want to see this go vertical. Keep practicing that way. Don't, you know, pick anything as if it were special. But if something, you know, says, I want this light to just go vertical light. I see you as vertical. This is unbound, you know. The light stand. The vertical light stand. The light stand of vertical light. The computer of vertical light. Computer of vertical. Unstuckness. Or never stuckness. Never stuckness. So again, this is the new norm. This is the new norm. This is the new norm. You see, keep working on it. And why did it establish it as a new norm? Like climbing Mount Everest, you go up and make a, you know, another camp. Say, okay, this is our new camp. And then you just hang out there for a while, get used to the air. And then you go up to a higher elevation and then another camp. So we just keep going over and over and over this, so it becomes the new norm for us. This is how you do it, the new norm. Keep, establish a new norm. That's what takes the work. Anybody can look at, parrot something that some teacher said, but how do you make it the new norm? You know, how do you make in your day a new normal that you say, okay, this is my new house? You know, that, well, that's the tortoise. The tortoise is carrying the house with it, with the tortoise carries the house with it, and then when it gets tired, you know, it stops and says, okay, this is where my house is now. Because the house is right there. And it, you know, it's the idea of the tortoise, so to speak, and plodding along. Whereas the hare is rush, 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 and then sleep, goes, oh, then it goes, well, where's my house? I don't know. Then it goes running back there, you know. It's always running back. It doesn't establish a new norm, a new house, a new normal. Establishing a new normal is an extra amount of work. Just imagine the amount of work that you have to pitch camp. You know, you have to build a fire. You know, it's a lot of work, right? You got to be very industrious and just be quiet and go to work and get that campfire going and get the camp leveled out and get the tent up and, you know, get everything ready. It takes extra work. takes extra work. So the extra work establishes a new normal. This is what we do. We establish this new normal. And we say, well, it's neither this nor that, meaning we're not trying to go forward or back. At a certain point, you can do the neither nor practice, full stop in the wild practice. There's, you know, all those tools are available to help out. And so then you become used to the territory and say, okay. And then from here, you feel confident to venture further, you know, venture even closer to acceptance. These are the tools of the trade. You have to be a tradesman. Tools of the trade. Professional. You know, be a professional. Know what your tools are and then know how to use them. Those are the professionals. You know, the real professionals, they've got the tools and know how to use them. The craftspeople, the artisans, you know, the ones that you know have the tools know how to use them. Well, we have to be a spiritual craftsman, a spiritual craftsperson, to spiritual crafts spirit. To use the tools. Mechanic has tools. You know, wealthy person in cars probably, I don't know what to do with it. Well, some of them do, but you know, most of them, bring it in the mechanic. Well, the mechanic knows what to do because they got tools, know how to use them. Mechanic will fix the car. Gets dirty and grimy and everything, but you know they know what they're doing, have the tools. So, you know, be a spiritual mechanic, get under the hood. You know, my namesake Ross Perot ran for president. You know, he said, "Hey, America, we got to get back under the hood here." You know, they were losing it. We're losing the know-how in having the tools and knowing how to use them, and we're becoming these consumeristic cows. You know, we got to get under the hood and fix what's wrong. He was right, and he was trying to show us. You know, we got to get back to work here. Didn't listen to him. You know, and basically they slandered and smeared and went after his family and everything. And he said, "Hey, to heck with this. I don't need this." Yeah, he did. You gotta be pretty tough, you know. You get into politics. Some would say you gotta be too tough. There's such a thing as having a thick skin, but so maybe you could get too thick. It's possible, you know. But. Gotta get under the hood. Take a look at the engine. Open it up. Even though you say, "I don't like this. I don't like working on cars," but I force myself to do so. I say, I don't want to be some prima donna, you know. So I worked on cars a lot. Rebuilt engines, you know, pulled transmissions, pulled them out, pulled engines out. Fix the the clutch. I didn't actually fix transmissions. That's a little too difficult. But did a lot of work on cars, different types of work, and suffered terribly from it. And just filthy. You know, put on your gorilla suit and get under there. You know, changed my own oil. You know, did everything on cars, but. Used to work on sports cars and had a sports car and had to, I think I pulled the engine at least four times, told tire engine, pulled, had to take a lift, a lift and lift it out, had to rent one, lift it out of the whole car because the clutch kept breaking. It had a graphite circular clutch plate. The stupid thing kept breaking. It was unbelievable. Unbelievable. I'd drive it for another couple hundred miles, brake again. Maybe I was not shifting properly, I don't know. In order to get to it, you had to pull the entire engine out. And then, of course, Volkswagens, you know, people worked on those a lot. Help people work on cars. So I've busted my knuckles up, got my fingernails dirty, and done everything. Plenty, 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 plenty. It's no fun, you know. It's not fun. It wasn't that much fun at all, but I forced myself to do it. Otherwise, you end up becoming a prima donna. I mean, you need to stay in touch with blue collarness, you know, really, which I'm still doing now. My work today now is this super blue collar, low blue collar work, very low blue collar work. But I go around everywhere I go is blue collar businesses. I see the people, they're good people. You know, they come to work every day, hard workers, and it's dirty, dangerous business and difficult and tough. But you know, you just say, okay. You know, got to do it. I got to pay the bills. I have to do this work. Spiritual path, very similar. I got to get liberated from the false idea of liberation. I'm dying. I'm getting sick. You know, everything's going wrong. It's terrible. I got to get free of this madhouse here. 'Cause I see it all, you know, it's horrible. Really. The stronger the ego gets, the more games it plays, the more terrible it becomes. It's the frog is, you know, the water gets hotter. And the frog says, "How do I get out of this pot? I can't take it anymore." Starts jumping, jumping, jumping. Keeps falling back in. You know what the frog needs to do? The frog needs to say, "Hey, water, go vertical. Pot, go vertical. Fire, go vertical. Frog, go vertical." You know, maybe just frog go vertical. You know, but no, have everything. You know, just say, "Hey, liberate everything. Liberate it from liberation. The idea of liberation. Go vertical. You're vertical right now. I see you as vertical. Meaning perception. I see it. I see all this is vertical." Devoid of any horizontal qualities. There's no heat then, you know, there's no trouble then. The fire is not horizontal fire, it's just an image of fire. The water is not hot water, it's just an image of water, so to speak, just an appearancing of water. It's all just an appearancing. So that's how the frog, you know, he gets free of suffering, not from jumping out of the pot. You know, there's a lid on the pot. The frog keeps jumping up and hitting his head on the lid. "Help, help, help, get out of this lid. How do I do?" You don't know, just say, "Lid, go vertical. Pot, go vertical. Everything, go vertical." Okay. Go vertical. I probably lost a lot of heat out here. I know I have. That's okay. 2 gigabytes. All right. Wow. It's using a lot of memory, this one. So, hang on to your blue-collar work ethic. Super important. As I said previously, in my previous life, I was very low, blue collar, destitute, poor, and had a super blue collar upbringing and just worked my entire life, just a total workaholic, just work. Super work ethic. Got me a long ways as far as, you know, recognize success. So I brought that with me into this life. And it's just, you know, hey. Time to go to work. It's time to go to work. Don't like it, you know? Yeah, don't like it. Don't like sitting out here in super cold weather outside here, shivering, you know, taping, but not really paying much attention to it. You know, we just put a coat on and, you know, get to work. You know, Jesus said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom," or whatever. Well, this is what he's getting at. You know, it's the lowly blue collar work ethic people. Who just says, "Hey, you know, I can't I can't be lazy. I cannot be lazy. Laziness is not an option. And yeah, you kind of envy the people who kind of take it easy, you know. I tried to ape that, you know, but I never did take it easy. Even when I was pretending to take it easy, I wasn't taking it easy. I was always trying to, everything I see, try to use it, you know, for greater clarity in whatever situation. I'm driving, I'm looking at license plates. How can that inspire me? How can this inspire me? Signs, the billboard, how can this be inspirational? You know, people, everything I see, I try to say, how can this be inspirational? Get me motivated. Help me, you know, help me focus on what's important. Just always, whatever, you know, always working, always working, always working, always working at it. This is what we're supposed to do here. Because if we don't get a return ticket, I guarantee you, this whole game of contrast the ego's playing, there's no escape within the game of contrast at all. Because the whole supposition is that there's some stuckness, which means reality isn't real. So the whole game, the pathway of the ego is stuck, is, you know, that's the only stuckness there is believing in stuckness. And if we believe in it, you can't get free of it. You know, you'll feel in this, stuck in this terrible game. You get a return ticket, won't be able to get out of it. Won't be able to get out of it. So you have to work at the spiritual path being liberated from the notion there's anything to be liberated from. And is that a liberation? Well, it's the only liberation there is that could possibly be, right? And even that ultimately is an illusion too. But it's okay to see it as a liberation. That's fine. Be liberated from the notion that there's anything to be liberated from. And, you know, so in other words, we're being liberated from this silly notion, which is really saying, hey, that is just a silly notion that liberates us from taking it seriously. So absolutely. The only problem we have is we forgot to laugh. We took it seriously. So we need to be liberated from the seriousness of this silly notion. There's anything that we could need to be liberated from in the first place. So, you know, we don't have to be dwelling in Arunachala in a cave like Ramana or wearing a loincloth or anything like that. No. That doesn't matter. It's just going to work is what matters. Using the tools, working at it, managing the success, that's what matters. You know, I hang out with workers, people who work, who work hard. It's just, you know, no excuses. Growing up, our family, there's no excuses. Get out on the weekend and work, dig the holes, cut the lawn, do this, there's no excuses. Now, I wanted to read books, you know, but when I mean reading books, I mean, I really read them. It was work. Yeah, if I get into reading, you know, I do it all day. I'll read 10, 12, 14, 16 hours a day. So I got these five books. I got to read all these five books today. And just, you know, just power through. It's work. So, praise yourself for your willingness to work. Don't be a lazy, shiftless spiritual welfare recipient. Don't take drugs. That interferes with your work. And don't try to work too fast. Don't take stimulus, because then that causes too much backlash. You see, this is a problem. You can make rapid progress, but then you get too much backlash, and you're not managing your success as you go along properly. And so the path becomes too erratic, and you can't go into the clearer and clearer recognitions. You have to be very grounded in order to do that, in using the tools in the right way, which I had trouble with today. It was so much success, I struggled today. But at least I knew I was struggling, and say, okay, you know, wow. This is a tough one. But anytime you go really fast, it gets tough. If you're on stimulants, you won't be able to put the brakes on in time, and then the backlash will hit you real, real bad. And then you'll think, oh, I need to take stimulants again to catch up again. And then you get into this vicious cycle, very vicious cycle. Stimulants can be a very vicious cycle. Absolutely, they can. Stay away from them. I keep telling myself, no caffeine, no caffeine, even though I think, well, it'll help me get me going. I said, no, absolutely not. This is very difficult to say no to caffeine, isn't it? Caffeine addiction is the worst addiction in the world, really. But nothing comes close. The second might be, nicotine. But ultimately, that messes up the path. Makes it too difficult. You get burned out. Don't want to burn out. You can't burn out on the path. You have to work out every day. Don't burn out. Work as fast as you can without burning out. Really, really important to keep the momentum going. Everyday momentum. And it's not good to go real fast for 2 days and then burn out and then not do anything for 3 days. That's not good. That's not good. I've experienced it many times. I've regretted it every time. I said, I can't do this again. It's horrible. How do I catch back up? I feel like I've gone, take 2 steps forward and 3 steps back. That's no fun. Taking the 2 steps forward was a lot of fun, but the 3 steps back was horrible. So now I don't take any steps back. I take 1 step forward and then say, okay, this is the new norm. Let me just get used to this and don't retreat from it. So that's better. It keeps your confidence going. The 2 steps forward, 3 steps back, it destroys your confidence. But 1 step forward every day builds more and more and more confidence. Think about it. You go 30 days. I have taken 30 steps forward. If I was taking, 2 steps forward and 3 steps back in that time frame, I would have taken, 12 steps forward and 18 steps back. 12 steps forward and minus 6. Instead of plus 30, you're minus 6 for the month. Think about that. So I'm having plus 30 months, instead of minus 6 months. And people who do the minus 6 months, after a while they say, hey, this is not working for me. It's ridiculous. It doesn't work. Well, it's the backlash that not managing, it's going too fast with the stimulants and then going 3 steps back. You keep losing a step every time you do that, go through that cycle. So that won't work. That won't get the job done. It's very tempting. I know sometimes I'm severely tempted. Gosh, it's like just drink a Coca-Cola. What the heck? I can't hurt you. Oh, yes, it can. It's better to take a nap than drink a Coca-Cola, believe me. Way better. I took a 20-minute nap today. Big help. Be a nap taker. That's one of the best drug there is take a nap. I never used to be able to take naps at all, up until recently. I could not ever take a nap. Because I had the wrong, approach, but now I'm a great nap taker. I just whatever, just lie down. Before you know it, poof, I'm out and poof, wake up in 20 minutes and, refreshed, a bit refreshed. That's the way to go. I would say taking a nap is the only drug anyone should consider. Now it's possible to sleep too much, sure, possible, but it's better to err by sleeping, too much than not at all. Take a nap. If you get tired, take a nap. This is another tool that's very important. Those who are trying to go too fast, driven by the personality, they can't take naps, they can't sleep, they can't stop, they can't take naps. I used to be that way. It's horrible. I can even take naps in cars now. Pull over and rest stop, just tilt the seat back and just sit there and just poof, out. And wake up again. Never could do that before. I'm always astonished I can do it now. Before there wasn't a ghost of a chance I could ever do that, and never could fall asleep like that. Couldn't even fall asleep at night. Couldn't fall asleep at all. Horrible. So, when you really feel down and you're thinking of caffeine, take a nap instead. Just keep trying, keep trying, keep trying. Eventually you'll be able to. You know, it's some sort of spiritual will thing that happens, that you're able to do it. You say, okay, I will do this. I had to will myself to do it. And I did that by full stop on the wow. I'm just not going to think of any, either going forward or backwards. Committing to no more movement, forwards or backwards. That enables me then to take a nap, to go to sleep. Whereas before, I'd still be thinking like, I need to make more progress, I need to make more progress. I don't want to go, I don't want to backslide, I don't want to backslide. And funny thing is, by doing that, I did backslide. You know, terrible. Very difficult, the path, you know, it's, but we won't make it any easier by just ignoring, you know, the advice here, you know, and hearing about this stuff. It helps out to know this, that we can take a nap by full stop in the wow, refuse to go forward anymore, say that's enough for the day. I'm going to now just stop here and take a nap. And it's a will, it's an act of will, actually. Have to will it, saying this is the way to go faster. This is the best way to go fast. I'm having diminishing returns with the other way. It just doesn't work. It's no good. It's no good. I have to do it this way. And that's just, you know, maturity and wisdom and discipline. So take that to heart. Okay. Gonna go out of the cold right now. Very great. Thanks for watching. I appreciate all the viewers. And again, be blue collar. Use the tools. Know the tools. Use the tools. Work at it every day. Take a nap if you're tired. Full stop in the wow. And be liberated from the notion, the silly, foolish notion, that there's anything to be liberated from. Very great. That's it.